Thank you all so much for being here. If any of you have friends who are wondering if this talk is being recorded, it is being recorded. You're more than welcome. You or your friends can email me, and I will send you the link to it afterwards. Okay. I would ask that you, like, not also record it. I'm having a recording made, but I want to be able to control where it goes. Are we all okay with that? Swag. Thank you. Also, Tara, when I get to the slide about the index cards, would you remind me to pass out the handout, please? Thank you. Okay. So, gay stuff. When I hung up posters for this presentation on campus a week ago, I was expecting to have to hang them up, you know, once, like you do. Instead, I've been hanging up posters every day because they've been taken down repeatedly. I don't say this as an accusation. To whoever took my posters down, maybe you're watching this recording, I love you and I forgive you. But what you're doing is not in support of the free speech that we value here at Hillsdale. The reason I'm bringing up the posters being taken down is to say thank you to all of you for being here anyway, at a presentation that obviously is a little bit controversial on this campus. A couple of quick things before we get started. First, this is a presentation, and I'm so happy you're here to watch. That also means it's not a debate. I would really love to hear your questions. At the end. There is gonna be time for Q&A, and I can stay to talk with you as long as you want. And I promise that if you hear me out respectfully, I will do the same for you. Also, just a quick content warning. In this presentation, I am going to talk about sex and also suicide. So just be aware. And finally, would you all pray with me? Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is sadness, joy. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is despair, O divine master, grant that I may not seek to be consoled so much as to console, to be understood as to understand, or to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
All right, so, whoop, that is not the button I wanted. What does it mean to be a gay Christian? I wanted to start this presentation with a few lines from a wonderful book that I've been enjoying recently by Gordon Allport. But I want to draw your attention to the last two sentences of this passage. Emotion may be an aid and not merely a hindrance to discovery. To stand wholly outside a phenomenon is to understand it less well than by entering in. What I'm inviting you all to do tonight is to enter into the experiences of Christians in the church who are gay. Not just to think of this as an abstract theological argument, but as something that affects real people. So please open your mind, be aware of your defenses, and listen. Also, just to clear this up, the full acronym is LGBTQQIAP. In order, it stands for lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer, questioning, intersex, asexual, and pansexual. However, if you don't want to say the whole thing, and you're trying to refer to the whole community, saying LGBT, LGBT+, or the LGBTQ community are all totally fine alternatives. Also, all of those have a maximum of 5 syllables, and African American has 6, so you can do it. You can also say GSM, which stands for gender and sexual minorities, but I mostly wanted to have this slide to point out that LGBT plus and gay are not the same thing. So in this presentation, when I talk about the LGBT community, I'm talking about everyone who identifies as not straight or not the gender they were assigned at birth. But when I say gay, I'm talking specifically about people who experience attraction to those of their same gender. So to start out, I wanted to talk about the three main approaches that I've seen in the church today across a variety of theological traditions and denominations to LGBT plus issues, for lack of a better term. Also, I just wanted to let you all know, this is not like some image of an old white dude preaching fire and brimstone that I found on the internet. That man is C.J. Mahaney. He was the head pastor of the church that I attended for the first 17 years of my life. C.J. Mahaney's teachings on homosexuality in many ways shaped what I used to believe about this issue. He now heads up a group, or is on the leadership board for, the Council for Biblical Manhood and Womanhood. I'll come back to that in a second. The first approach, denial. I made up this name, it's not like official anywhere. But basically this approach says that being gay or experiencing sexual desire for those of your same gender is a temptation and giving into it is willful and sinful. You might find a bit of variation here, but most people who take this approach believe that if you experience same-sex attraction, you can stop experiencing it, which is why they often express support for ex-gay ministries and conversion therapy. And we need to take a second here to be very serious about this. Conversion therapy does not deserve the word therapy in its title. It is a toxic and psychologically abusive practice that seeks to force people who experience same-sex attraction to stop experiencing those things altogether. There are hundreds of stories of people who have gone through conversion therapy and ended up extremely depressed or with PTSD or trying to commit suicide, and in many tragic cases, succeeding. This is not a joke. Obviously, I don't really agree with this approach, mostly because of the support for conversion therapy. But it's important to realize that many Christian churches today, particularly in the Protestant tradition, do take this approach. And for people who hold this view, I hear you. I used to hold this view. And I understand why you may think this way. But I want you to understand the full ramifications of these ideas. What you're looking at now are lines from the Nashville Statement, which was written by the Council for Biblical Manhood and Womanhood, which my former head pastor, C.J. Mahaney, is a part of. The Nashville Statement was released last year around my birthday. And it's a document that attempts to explain the proper biblical position of evangelical churches towards LGBT issues. I did not put the words "we deny" in all caps, by the way. They did that all by themselves. But basically they say that identifying as gay or transgender is not consistent with God's holy purposes in creation, and that sexual attraction for the same sex is not part of God's good design. I'd like you to meet Kevin Garcia. Kevin Garcia was a young man who went through 10 years of that conversion therapy I was just talking about. In his case, it included fasting, praying, missionary work, and even attempted exorcisms. After 10 years of this treatment, Kevin attempted suicide by getting really drunk and then driving his car around, hoping he would get in an accident and die. Thankfully, he was not successful, and eventually he turned away from conversion therapy to pursue another approach that I'm going to discuss in a few minutes. But this is something that Kevin wrote about what it was like to be within or entrenched in the denial approach. He says that he thought of his homosexual attractions, as he called them, as a cancer to be cured, a tumor on my heart to be cut out. This horrifies me. especially because this is something that Kevin, and not for lack of trying, was never able to change about himself. It is my opinion that if, as a church, we teach gay people that an experience that is integral to their life is a cancer or a toxic disease, that's only going to drive them to despair. So then we have our second approach, which I'm calling celibate acknowledgement. This approach is common in the Catholic tradition. You'll also find it in some Protestant denominations or churches. Sometimes it honestly depends on which one you go to or who the head pastor is there. But in this approach, they do recognize, for the most part, that being gay is not a choice. So if you experience same-sex attraction, as they would call it, that's not something that you can necessarily stop or get rid of. However, they do refer to same-sex attraction as objectively disordered, which is a quotation I've pulled from a document released by the Vatican in 2005 regarding whether men who experience same-sex attraction can be admitted to the priesthood. And their answer is no, they can't. They also regard same-sex sexual acts as intrinsically immoral and contrary to the natural law. And I just want to highlight something here for a second. Catholics who take this view, for the most part, do not base it on the Bible, which is something I didn't know until a few weeks ago. The Catholic argument against homosexual behaviors is largely based on natural law philosophy, such as the kind that I think you might find in the theology of the body. Correct me if I'm wrong. She's snapping, so it's probably right. But in this view, celibacy is required of all gay Christians in order to remain members of their local church. And celibacy doesn't just mean abstaining from sex. It also means cutting oneself off from all romantic relationships, including flirting or dating, experiences that I hope most of us have enjoyed at some point. This is Leslie. And I want to take a moment to point out that it's not actually that conducive to the point I'm interested in arguing to introduce you all to Leslie. Because Leslie is a celibate gay Christian, and he chose celibacy with the support of a tight-knit church community, which he was very lucky to have. And he's still celibate today. Leslie has this to say about his choice to be celibate. He says that he sees his inclination to be in a sexual relationship with men as something that leads him into the vocation of committing his life to Christ and celibacy, committing himself to community, hospitality, and friendship. So clearly Wesley is doing okay, or at least he was at the time that he wrote this. And sharing this with you all doesn't make it any easier for me to argue what I'm about to argue next. But the reason that I bring up Wesley's story is to underscore the fact that I have nothing but love and respect for gay Christians who do choose celibacy. And while I think that it can be a choice that often drives people into deep depression and despair, it's also something that can be personally fulfilling. Sometimes it depends on the person and the community that they're in. What I wish is that not all gay Christians were forced to make this choice. This is the last approach that I'm going to discuss, and it's the one that I'll spend more time on in the next section. In this approach, being gay is for life, and it's not a choice, similar to celibate acknowledgement. However, if you take a gay-affirming approach, then you believe that loving, self-sacrificial, and Christ-centered marriages are affirmed and are pleasing to God, regardless of the gender of the individuals involved. Same-sex sexual activity, likewise, is affirmed as a positive way to strengthen the marriage relationship within the context of the marriage relationship. Most Christians who take a gay-affirming approach don't support the moral rightness of premarital or extramarital sex, just like most of you, I imagine. And finally, and this is so important,
In this approach, gay people are called to live a holy life and conform themselves to the image of Christ. It actually turns out that in this approach, gay people aren't that different from anyone else. All right, and now for the $64,000 question. Is the affirming approach biblically viable? I want to look at this in two ways. First, I'm going to take a look at some scriptural arguments in favor of affirming gay Christians in being gay. And second, I want to look at some people who've had experiences that led them to this conclusion, because I think that both approaches are equally important. And I'll talk about that more a little bit later. But first, I want you to meet Matthew. In case you haven't seen him or heard of him before, this is Matthew Vines. And at the age of 21, which, hi, is how old I am right now, he published a book called God and the Gay Christian, The Biblical Case for Same-Sex Relationships. One of the things that I really like about Matthew Vines' work is that he takes a high view of Scripture, which is to say he believes that Scripture is inerrant and is suitable for teaching, correction, and all the other things in that verse in one of the Timothys, whose reference I'm forgetting right now. But because I was raised in a very conservative church with a conservative theology, I appreciate the fact that Matthew doesn't try to twist the Bible to fit a particular political view, or at least it seems to me that he doesn't. And I want to underscore the fact that I don't have time here to do full justice to even part of Matthew's work on this issue. What I'm about to give you is a very brief overview of some of his arguments. So if things seem fuzzy or like there are logical holes, I promise you, he addresses them. But I don't have time to. So if you're interested, I would highly recommend that you read this book, or that you check out the transcript of a speech he gave about it, which is freely available on his website at matthewvines.com. So there are six biblical passages that deal with same-sex sexual behavior in some way. And in his work, in his book, Matthew deals with each of them in turn. Like I said, this is a super brief overview. But the first passage is Genesis 19, which tells the story of two angels who visit the earth in the form of men and are persuaded by Lot to stay with him in the city of Sodom. During the night, a group of men from Sodom come to the house of Lot and threaten to gang rape the men, demanding that Lot bring them out so that they can know them in the biblical sense, if you have the ESV, like I do. And a lot of people take this passage and subsequent references to Sodom throughout the Old Testament as a city filled with sin, as undeniable proof that same-sex sexual activity, I mean it's men having sex with men, must be a bad thing. But there's a little bit more to it. If we look at the historical context, we see that gang rape of men by men was actually a common tactic for domination, humiliation, and aggression in military times, particularly in military contexts. The men who were threatening to gang rape Lot's visitors were not doing so out of a genuine desire for relational fulfillment, but out of a desire to be violent and inhospitable. And indeed, in all of the Old Testament references to the sin of Sodom, it is cited that it is inhospitality that was the primary thing at fault. Just something interesting to think about. The other two Old Testament passages that we have to deal with are Leviticus 18:22 and 20:13, both of which say the thing that goes kind of like, a man shall not lie with a man as with a woman, it is an abomination. Okay, so a lot of Christians look at these two verses and say, hold the phone, the game stops here. Obviously, the Bible says it's wrong, so it can't be good today, right? Well, maybe. But there's another way that we can look at this too. Both of these verses appear in Leviticus, which is part of the Pentateuch, the old Jewish law. I don't know if some of you remember a guy called Jesus Christ. But the default Christian approach today, and the one that has been our default ever since the New Testament apostles decided that it was a good approach for Christians to believe that we have been freed from the old Jewish law by the saving and redeeming work of Jesus Christ. Our approach has always been that the laws of the Old Testament do not apply to us, including all of those laid out in Leviticus. And that includes both of these. Another thing that Matthew Vines points out in his argument is that in the New Testament, like in Acts, when the apostles are debating all this stuff, the tenets of the old law that they're most concerned with aren't homosexuality by a long shot. What they're far more concerned with are things like kosher dietary laws, so who gets to eat what, depending on what they believe, and male circumcision, which is a huge thing in Jewish culture. And it seems reasonable to believe that if the apostles decided that both of these huge tenets of Jewish law did not apply to Christians, which we would all agree today, they don't. Vines argues that it's also reasonable to believe that neither of these verses in Leviticus are applicable to Christians either. So under these interpretations that Matthew Vines argues for, none of these Old Testament passages are applicable to or are able to condemn loving, monogamous, committed same-sex relationships, which, once again, is what gay-affirming theology is arguing in favor of. Not promiscuous gay sex all over the everywhere, but monogamous, committed relationships. However, there are also three New Testament passages to deal with. And due to the fact that Christ has freed us from the old law, one could easily argue that these are much more pressing. But Matthew Vines has some interesting thoughts about these as well. And again, I want to share a brief overview with you. The first passage is Romans 1, 26 through 27, which discusses sexual acts that are, quote, contrary to nature. And it discusses both men and women engaging in these acts. Finally, some lesbian inclusion for once. However, something interesting to note in the larger context of Romans 1 is that Paul is making an argument with very precise logic about idolatry. All throughout the preceding verses that come before 26 and 27, he's talking about people who know God because God has revealed himself so richly to them and yet turn away to worship idols, turning what they are naturally oriented towards, the worship of God, towards something that is unnatural for them, which is idolatry. And Paul then speaks of same-sex sexual behavior on the part of men and women as something that is contrary to their natures. However, and I just want you all to recognize here that in order to take this particular one of Matthew Vines' arguments seriously, it requires accepting the idea that being gay is part of one's nature, that if you're gay, God created you this way, that it wasn't a mistake, and it's not something you can change. If you don't accept that, this argument won't make a lot of sense, and that's fine. I just want you to be aware of that. So, all of that to say, if gay people don't choose their orientation or the attractions they feel, and they're instead created by God with a nature that is oriented towards those of their same gender, the logic of this passage would not apply to them. Because, in fact, engaging in a heterosexual relationship for a gay person is the most unnatural thing that they could do. And it actually seems quite unreasonable, according to Paul's logic, for that to be an expectation the church would have of gay people. The last two passages to look at are 1 Corinthians 6:9 and 1 Timothy 1:10, which in most of your Bibles probably translate the word arsenikoites from the Greek as men who practice homosexuality. However, this is a compound Greek word that comes from two other words, arsen meaning male, and koites meaning them. And Matthew Vines makes a slightly humorous point that just like the English words butterfly and honeymoon don't actually tell us anything about their meanings just from their constituent words, we also can't automatically know that a Greek word that appears to say male bed means men who practice homosexuality. It's a lot of a linguistic leap to make, suffice it to say. However, that's not the end of the story, because there are other Greek texts that use this word. So other contextual data from the same time period that these books of the Bible were written suggest that the word arsenopoietes refers to some kind of economic exploitation with a sexual aspect. And in other places where this word appears, it's always in lists of sins that are economic in nature, rather than sexual, suggesting that perhaps what Paul was referring to in these lists of vices was people who are economically exploitative and manipulative towards others, not people having gay sex. So we look back at all this, and according to Matthew Vines' argument, there is no contextual evidence for linking these condemning statements to loving, monogamous, committed same-sex relationships either. Again, if you accept the idea that being gay is a part of your nature and something that you're created with. He says one more thing about this that I think is really good, so I want to read it to you in full. Our discussion of this issue, of the gay issue, can't take place in the realm of abstractions, of musings about ideal design, ideal gender roles, as though gay people don't even exist. Jesus placed a particular focus on those others overlooked, on those who were outcast, on mistreated and marginalized minorities. And if we are working to emulate the life of Christ, then that's where our focus needs to be too. I have two more people to introduce you to before I finish this section. This is Justin Lee. He's the author of Torn, Rescuing the Gospel from the Gays versus Christians Debate, which is an outstanding book. I highly recommend it. Now, Justin isn't a guy who became a Christian later in life. In fact, he was a Christian in high school. His classmates nicknamed him God Boy. However, Justin also had a secret in high school that he was determined he would never tell anyone. He was gay. And when he finally came out, he initially decided to remain celibate. But as he tells in his book, Torn, his experiences with the ex-gay ministry changed his mind as he met dozens of men, often older, adult, even middle-aged men, who told him they had been trying for decades to change their sexual orientation with no success. Justin writes this: "The more I studied, the more convinced I became that we Christians had applied a different standard to the homosexuality texts than we had to other scriptural texts, and that condemning Christ-centered relationships solely based on gender was actually inconsistent with biblical teaching." I think this is a nice summary of some of the points that Matthew Vines makes, that when we pull verses from Leviticus, or verses that use a Greek word we don't really understand, what we're doing is using the Bible to bludgeon people whose experiences we may not fully understand. This is Julie Rogers. When she came out as gay in high school, her parents also connected her with an ex-gay ministry, like Justin. And she actually remained celibate throughout her 20s, becoming a popular campus speaker for why she was a gay and celibate Christian. Interestingly, though, she eventually had a change of heart about her friends who were involved in committed same-sex relationships. She describes seeing good fruit born in these people's lives as a result of the partnered relationships that they were in. And she eventually changed her mind completely to a gay-affirming theology, resulting in her subsequent engagement to a woman named Amanda. And Julie is still a strong Christian. to read to you that Julie wrote in the blog post in which she explained that she was changing her position. A big thing to do if you're a blogger with lots of readers who agree with you. Julie says, "Most of the Christians I know love gay people. They simply underestimate the burden of feeling marginalized, scrutinized, unwanted, and relationally toxic. It's easy for straight Christians to underestimate how exhausting it is to simply exist in communities that feel uncomfortable with gays. We're constantly wondering if we should tell the truth when asked that question, or sleep on the floor when there's room in the bed, or cut that hug short, or shut down those feelings, or leave the church altogether. Those fears subside around friends who simply delight in who we are as whole human beings made in the image of God." One last thing before we get out of this section. The Bible says that the law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. Jesus teaches in his Sermon on the Mount that we can know false prophets and false teachings by the fruit that is born by what they say. And Romans 8 says to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. This month, a study is being released in the American Journal of Preventive Medicine entitled Religiosity Associated with Sexual Minority Suicide Ideation and Attempt. This study is essentially a scientific way of telling you what I already told you, the story of Kevin Garcia. This study analyzed data collected in 2011 from over 21,000 college students. And what they found is that students who identified as LGBT+ were at an increased risk of suicide ideation and attempt. And the reason I included on this slide that this includes 16.4% of those identified as questioning is because questioning is a really common way for people to identify who are Christians and aren't sure what to call themselves. Also, increasing religiosity, according to this study, increased the risk of suicide ideation for gay and lesbian students while decreasing that same risk for their straight counterparts. Remember the Bible verses that I just quoted to you about the law of the Lord reviving the soul? It seems to me that if the teachings of the church are increasing the risk of suicide among LGBT youth, we may want to reconsider what it is we mean when we talk about the law of the Lord. And then, so, in 2015, the Public Religion Research Institute found that about 7% of Americans identify as LGBT. A quick calculation will tell you that on Hillsdale's campus, statistically speaking, there are about 100 LGBT students. Now, this study doesn't suggest that all of them are at increased risk of suicide ideation and attempt. But this does mean that we should take very seriously and carefully the words that we say and the things that we do. Because there are students on this campus who are directly affected by Christian teachings about this issue. All right, so we've talked a lot about the Bible and other gay people, but now we're going to talk about me, because I'm the one giving this presentation, and I can't. So throughout this presentation, starting with that wonderful passage from Borden Allport, I've emphasized personal experience. The theological arguments, like Matthew Vines and stuff, are great, but ultimately they're not actually what I find most convincing when it comes to this issue. If you're straight, it's probably really hard to imagine what it's like to be gay. And I've tried to give you a little glimpse of it with some of the different stories I've shared throughout this presentation. Because one of my goals here is to broaden your view to include more perspectives than just yours. And all of that means there's one more person for us to meet. So like many of you, I was raised in a conservative Christian home. Both of my parents are strong proponents of what I've today described as the denial approach, which is why I'm still not out to them. I realized I wasn't straight here in college, and I was absolutely terrified. Because when you're raised thinking that being gay is one of the worst things that can happen to you, I mean, there's not really another reaction to have. Through a very long and difficult journey, I came to identify as an asexual, gay, or lesbian, whatever, woman, which is why I wear both of these bracelets that you may all have seen me wearing just these past few weeks. This one is a rainbow, so obviously it's gay pride. But this one is for asexual pride, which, in case you're not aware, means that I don't experience sexual attraction to anyone. So you're all safe, don't worry. But in actuality, what that means is that I don't feel sexual attraction to men or women. So when I say I identify as gay, what I mean is that I feel a romantic inclination towards women that basically never veers into the sexual. Also, today is a really special day for me, and I didn't plan it this way, but May 2nd, 2016, was actually the first time that I ever came out to a group of my friends. And it was one of the happiest and most fulfilling moments of my life. I celebrate May 2nd every year as my coming out anniversary, or whatever. But thank you all for being here, unbeknownst to you, to celebrate. Alright, so I haven't made a secret during this presentation of the fact that I am gay affirming, and I take that theological viewpoint very seriously. But why? Honestly, no one argued me into it. Not even me. I had never heard of Matthew Vines until 8 or 9 months ago. But in some sense, I've held this position since the very first time I wrote down in my journal, "I might not be straight?" question mark. Because my doubts and fears about my life and the future have never had anything to do with God's attitude towards me. I was raised to believe that God loves me no matter what I do, and I've never doubted that. What I have doubted is whether or not I can thrive spiritually in a church that responds to me and my desire to be in a long-term, same-sex committed relationship with fear and suspicion. That's been something that's been really difficult for me, and I'm still trying to find my place in the Christian church today. I'm not going to pretend that it's easy or like I have it all figured out, but doing this presentation was an important step for me in that process. So again, thank you all for being here to support me in that. Okay, so what does this mean for all of you who aren't graduating? I think that at Hillsdale, we can do a lot for students who have to live under the reign of statements like this. This statement was released in 2016, you can find it online, by the Hillsdale College Administration. And it explains, "The college has always understood morally responsible sexual acts to be those occurring in marriage and between the sexes." What that is to say is that every day that I've walked around this campus and seen heterosexual couples holding hands or having PDA, oh my gosh, please stop. The thought I've always had is, it would be nice if I could do that here, but I can't. So what should you do if someone comes out to you at Hillsdale? First off, the advice that I'm about to give you is for everyone, regardless of what approach you take. This is applicable because it doesn't matter what you think about the person's behavior. This is about being a decent human being. So here's how to do that. First, listen carefully and let them know they are heard and acknowledged. I mean, seriously, like, make sentences come out of your mouth like, "I hear you," and "I see you." Because for most closeted LGBT students, not being seen and heard is one of the most painful things they go through. Also, try to understand what they're going through from their point of view, not yours. Again, this doesn't mean that you have to give up your beliefs, but it does mean that you should try to have a little bit of empathy with their experiences and how difficult it can be to identify as LGBT on a campus that actively and explicitly does not affirm them. Also, respect their privacy. For many people who identify as LGBT, they're out to some people and not to others. And that's a choice that every LGBT person gets to make on their own, with no pressure from anybody else. But that also means that if someone comes out to you, it would be extremely rude and in fact harmful to spread that information around. So ask them how comfortable they are with, or maybe ask them who else they're out to, just to get a sense of how comfortable they are with it. And if they're like, you're maybe the seventh person I've come out to ever, like, keep it on the down low, okay? And then finally, be willing to talk about it after they come out to you. One of the worst things that can happen to someone who comes out is to have their friend that they're coming out to say, yeah, I hear you, I love you, cool, and then never talk about it again. Because that perpetuates the feeling of invisibility the student used to endure before they came out. So if you have a friend and you know they're gay and they come up to you and they're like, I'm having a hard time being gay, I need to talk about it. Like, take it seriously, okay? Being gay isn't like a cakewalk right after you come out. And people still need to talk about stuff. So be a decent human being and listen. Also, in the same document that I just quoted, Hillsdale College states, as a place of liberal learning, Hillsdale College has always welcomed thoughtful inquiry and civil debate. So, I'm gonna guess that the poster taking down thing was probably not accomplished by somebody who had read this document. But that being said, Hillsdale College should be a place where we actively and openly discuss this issue. And I have some tips for how to be decent about that as well. So please do discuss this issue. Get with your student organizations and clubs. I know you're out there and host presentations and debates. The last time that LGBT issues were publicly discussed on this campus was the spring of 2015, when John Corvino debated a religious scholar. Nothing has been said about it here since. And we debate every other controversial issue on this campus: abortion, healthcare, immigration, government intervention in people's lives. Like, honestly, why is this the conspicuous exception? This exclusion from campus discourse is a form of alienation towards LGBT plus students. And I want you to know that even if you don't feel that way, we do. And we feel it pretty strongly. So if you have the opportunity, do invite someone to speak on campus about this issue. Write collegiate editorials about it. Talk to your friends about it. In the dining halls. Gay isn't a bad word, I promise. But honestly, and remember, I'm asking you to do this regardless of which approach you take. I don't think we all need to agree, but I do think we need to talk about it. This is a picture of me. The Bible in this picture is the same Bible that I've had since I was 12 or 13 years old. And although I've gone through a lot since receiving this Bible, and even since having that picture taken in my senior year of high school, as part of my senior photo shoot, I thought it was artsy. I still believe that God loves everyone, and that we should all love one another with the same love that he showed to us. Okay, index card time. I'm thinking about you, so I'm gonna pass these out. These are a list of resources. Take one down, pass it around, or whatever you do. I am going to unabashedly clear to celibate acknowledgement are really common in the Christian tradition. It's super easy to find information about those approaches on the internet or wherever, okay? But it's not easy to find information about gay affirming theology. So if you do want to look up at, so if you do want to get more resources about that, they're all on that sheet of paper. I'm absolutely certain I don't have enough for you, but guess what? My personal email is maryblunderman@gmail.com. If you want to continue this conversation with me privately, or yell at me, or whatever, you're more than welcome to do it over email. And if you send me an email, I can also send you a list of the resources. Cool beans. And then, oh yeah, as far as the index cards, I would really love to get your thoughts. There are two mason jars right next to Gabe Meyer, and then over there, like kind of behind Doggett. So if you would like to drop an index card in one of those jars as you leave, and let me know what you thought about this presentation. Any resources you'd like me to investigate from any approach, I'd love to know what you've been reading and thinking about. Or any scripture references or verses for me. I would really love to receive those. That'd be great, and I appreciate it. St. Thomas Aquinas said, "We must love them both, those whose opinions we share and those whose opinions we reject, for both have labored in the search for truth, and both have helped us in finding it." That is to say, no matter what approach you take to this issue, I love you because I appreciate the fact that maybe by standing in contrast to me, you've helped me to figure out what I believe. And I think that's valuable. Finally, John O'Donohue is an Irish Catholic poet and theologian whose work I dearly love. Whoever you are, however you identify, or whatever you believe, this truly captures my deepest wish for you. And I hope you'll indulge me in taking a moment to say this blessing for all of you and for myself as well. May you recognize in your life the presence, power, and light of your soul. May you realize that you are never alone, that your soul in its brightness and belonging connects you intimately with the rhythm of the universe. May you have respect for your individuality and difference. May you realize that the shape of your soul is unique, that you have a special destiny here, that behind the facade of your life, there is something beautiful and eternal happening. May you learn to see yourself with the same delight, pride, and expectation with which God sees you at every moment. Thank you so much.
Are you saying that because Scripture does not condemn homosexuality, and that so you're saying that because God's, would you argue then that God's word does not because it condemn homosexuality, and so that it should be okay?
I'll be quite honest with you. I'm not super familiar, at least right now, with the passage to which you're referring. And I would be more than happy to take a look at it and let you know what I think outside of the context of this room and this discussion. Is that all right with you?
Sure.
Thank you. If you want, you can leave your email address on one of the index cards and I'll get back to you about that.
Sure.
Yes.
Thank you so much for your courage and your humility. I really appreciated your talk.
I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about people who choose, rather than celibacy, like a mixed orientation marriage.
Okay, yeah, definitely. Mixed orientation marriage. Wow, that's a time. So, I know, because I've dated two men, and it was a time. So, a mixed orientation marriage. And if you need to leave, please, you're welcome to grab some banana bread and just walk on the way out. Mixed orientation marriage is an approach that's been advocated in the past by some churches, mostly those who took the denial approach that I've expressed it here. Generally speaking, it's a super harmful thing to do because the gay person in the marriage doesn't actually feel any attraction or interest in their marriage partner beyond, well, I guess we're friends who hold hands sometimes, right? And it's certainly not an option that I support. Like, if I had a gay friend who was like, hey, you know, I'm gay, but I really think I should just marry this person because it'll make my life easier, I'd be like, no, like, it won't, right? It causes a lot of harm when those people end up going through counseling after they divorce their mixed orientation marriage partner. So, yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, definitely. Any other questions? Yes.
Thank you so much for your conversion again. I'd be interested to hear your thoughts on conversion therapy a little bit more extended. So
yes.
There are different types of, like, for those who, you know, identify as questioning,
sure.
Who might go through that counseling, where it's clearly not employing kind of problematic practices of extreme conversion therapy. I want to hear your thoughts on that, because part of, I think, a worry for probably more conservative individuals would be that there are pushes to outlaw any type of therapy that would be provided for individuals, specifically minors, who might be in a questioning spot, but clearly don't employ those sorts of tactics or those practices.
Can you clarify for me a little bit what you mean by extreme practices? Just like, what are you thinking of?
I can't recall, but I know there are practices where you know, like, kids will be subjected to heterosexual pornography, things like that, or they'll be forced to kind of more or less try to build some sort of attraction, psychological attraction, sexual attraction to the other sex, through just kind of strange, unhelpful means.
Sure.
So, and if the other thing with that is if you would see that there being a difference between, say, individuals or practices that want to see people, you know, that are willing to assist those type of people that are questioning versus just kind of trying to force them in problematic ways.
Yes, yeah. Man, in so many ways, my answer to your question is, it depends. Because there are some kinds of therapy that I think really do deserve the term therapy. Rogerian client-centered therapy is such a type, where the goal is not to force the individual to conform to the strictures of a certain religious belief system, but rather to help that individual discover what it is that their psyche and their person is truly directed towards. That kind of therapy I'm totally fine with, because I don't feel that it's trying to push something unnecessary or unhelpful on the person who identifies as questioning. But you bring up another interesting point, which is, you know, what do you do with the Christian who maybe identifies as questioning, so I'm having these desires but I'm not really sure, and seeks out counseling because they, you know, they want to not feel those desires anymore, and they have such a strong desire not to feel them. As I tried to explain in this presentation, at least for the vast majority of Christians who try that approach, the desires are still there. And I think that what many psychologists and psychiatrists agree upon today is that it is, in fact, harmful, especially for minors, to try and force them not to feel something that they do, in fact, feel. So that is to say, I'm okay with therapy that is oriented towards helping a person develop a healthy, constructive, and meaningful life. But because of the beliefs that I have about sexual orientation being something that can't be changed, I clearly can't support any kind of therapy
that does try to change the desires that a person naturally has. Does that make sense? Yeah. Anyone else? Yes.
So you mentioned the natural law approach to it. Is there anything like maybe on the sheet or that you know of that has the gay affirming kind of response to that side of it?
Gay affirming response to natural law. What a great question. I am going to tentatively say John Corvino, who I think is on there, but he might not be. I know that he's debated natural law scholars in the past, and if you take a look at maybe his website or some of his books, I know he has one that's called What's Wrong with Homosexuality, that may be interesting. But otherwise, I mean, what I would do and then email you about it is honestly the same thing that you could do, which is Google gay affirming response to natural law theology. So, yeah.
John, how do you spell his last name?
Corvino. John Corvino.
Thank you.
Yeah. Anyone else? Yes.
Hey, Mark.
Hi, Jonathan.
thank you for giving the talk. I very much appreciate it.
Of course. Thank you for coming.
I'm going to try and put this both very respectfully and a bit bluntly.
Okay.
So you said earlier on in the talk that you see a problem with telling people that something integral to their lives is like cancer or whatever that needs to be cut out. You see that
yes.
It's damaging.
Yes.
Isn't that, in some sense, precisely what Christianity is? Isn't the point of Christianity that we all of us, not certainly not just one community, but all human beings, are sinners who have an old nature that is fallen and corrupt, and that we do need to put off?
That's a really wonderful question. And I'll be totally honest. When you put it like that, it's easy to go either way. It's easy to say, yeah, people are created with a lot of sinful desires. And we do need to put those on and put on love and Christ-likeness. The thing that I think is important and that I tried to emphasize in this talk is that according to my personal experience and the personal experience of many other Christians, being gay isn't like other sins. You can try to, you know, work towards your sanctification from your inclination towards lust, greed, or envy. And over time, you will see improvement in those qualities in your life through Christ's redeeming work, right? However, most gay Christians who, again, Kevin Garcia, 10 years, man, I mean, this guy was committed. Nothing. His desires were still there and still as strong as before. And to me, what that suggests is that being straight or being gay is a little bit different from being inclined to lust or excess or greed or pride. I mean, I'm super inclined to pride, but I'm trying to get better about that and to have more humility. And I think it's working. Oh, maybe I shouldn't have said that. But that being said, I don't see being gay as a sinful part of our nature. Just like I don't see being straight as a sinful part of your nature. Although I suppose it could. So yeah, that's really my response to that. If you want to talk more about that, because it is a super interesting question, shoot me an email. I'd love to talk about it.
Thank you.
Yeah. Any other questions? Yes.
So I noticed you use Vines as your main interpretation of the Bible.
Did I use Sargu?
Vines,
yes.
Like his interpretation.
Yes.
Do you know anything about, like, I guess, a response from the whole mainstream, like, biblical community?
So there is actually, if you go to MatthewVines.com, there's an article that Matthew Vines wrote that is a response to John Piper, or no, maybe it was Tim Keller. One of those two. I get it mixed up. Which was a response to Matthew Vines' like original like book and video and everything. And it's an interesting debate to read. So that's where I would go. Essentially, like, a lot of it is just kind of the same things that are sort of regurgitated by people who hold the denial approach. You know, like, you're applying your modern ideas about homosexuality to an ancient biblical culture that knew nothing about that. And again, Matthew Vines does a good job of addressing those concerns in his book, which is a great resource, so you should read it. But that being said, MatthewVines.com has got some interesting stuff on there. Yes?
Hey, Mary.
Hi.
I was just wondering, what would your advice be to gay people who might have turned themselves away from Christianity from negative experiences with using?
views on it.
Yes.
What would you tell them if they feel isolated or just don't want anything to do with it?
First off, God loves you so much, even when you feel like his people don't. Otherwise, that's something that's really hard to deal with. And there are many people who make a complete break with Christianity and never come back because of that very experience. That's something that I personally was very sorely tempted to do. And it's only because life without Christ feels empty to me that I ultimately wasn't able to do that. That being said, there are a lot of kind of doors starting to open up to jump back into Christianity in a way that isn't, you know, deeply negating of who you may feel yourself to be as a person. The Episcopalian Church is well known for being open to gay Christians when many other Protestant denominations, who are they Protestant, are not. And aside from that, honestly, sometimes it depends from individual pastor to pastor. But I think my biggest piece of advice would be, even if you've temporarily given up on the church, don't give up on Jesus, right? The Bible speaks. His word is still true today. It's true as it was 2,000 years ago. And I think that there's a lot in that daily practice of reading and praying. Even if it's hard for you to be in a building with other people you feel like don't affirm who you are, that is important to maintaining a sense of spirituality through that experience. Yes.
Thanks for doing this talk. So my question is, I know you've been to a lot of different churches over the past years.
Ooh, yeah.
And what have you found, like, helpful from the pastors of those churches as opposed to, like, harmful? Like, I guess that's my question.
Yeah. Wow.
That's definitely probably me.
So, man, I think, let me share a little experience that I had that maybe will be conducive to answering this question. This was summer of 2016, so it was just after I came out for the first time, glitter. And I visited an Eastern Orthodox church for the very first time. And I was in love, I was enthralled. It was beautiful, the liturgy was amazing. I hadn't even been to liturgical churches that much, and I was like, this is my jam. Like, there was this guy who turned around and said, like, good morning to me, and I almost just, like, busted out crying. Like, it was so amazing. And if you know me, you know I don't bust out crying in public. So, like, there we go. But that being said, like, right after the service. So Eastern Orthodox people, if you're not aware, are a really big fan of eating after church. So they're like, bagels, come have bagels with us. So I'm like, all right, you know, during the fellowship hall, we're having bagels. And I sit down at a table, like, by myself, because, you know, I'm me. And some, like, other, I don't know, like, older guys just kind of wandered up and like, hey, I saw you sitting by yourself. We just wanted to come say hi. And I was like, how sweet. Like, this is very nice. Hooray. And then, like, their priest comes over and he introduced himself. And I was like, yeah. And then they, like, sat down and started talking about how transgender people were the sign of, like, how God has abandoned the modern age. And I was like, no. Really? Like, it was that much of a, like, all right. So I guess that's one thing is, I mean, for me, as a gay person who takes a gay-affirming approach to theology, pastors who don't have a gay-affirming approach to theology are a little bit of a spiritual turnoff, so to speak. But that being said, something that I do find helpful from pastors is those who are willing to sit and listen to my experiences without judgment. Those who are willing to sit down and let the words, I'm gay, come out of my mouth, and not immediately be like, and Leviticus says this, the end, right? Yeah, so I honestly haven't been able to find a church in the Hillsdale area where I really feel like I can be part of the community there. I plan to keep looking for a church like that after I graduate. I have no idea what it's going to be like. Maybe I'll go Episcopalian, pray for me. but yeah, so those are kind of my thoughts on that. Yes.
Yeah, so as a member, I guess, of Hillsdale College's administration, how can me and others like me who are gay affirming be a better advocate for you? Because like obviously that what was released in 2016 is completely despicable in my opinion and against our mission, also in my opinion. So, which is why I can like tolerate still working here. What can I do? How can I help?
Yeah, first of all, I love your tank top, Evelyn. Nice.
Thank you so much. I'm like also really powerful, like wonderful about this.
much for coming.
Absolutely.
And I'm really delighted that you asked that question. I think the biggest thing that would help me and other LGBT students to feel more welcome on this campus, especially now that we have a giant chapel looming over us all the time, which, I mean, I'm a fan of. I think it's going to be a really freaking beautiful chapel. But still, concrete reminder of the fact that most people here have feelings about us. I think, like I was saying, just talking about it on campus more, you know, feeling like the administration is willing to bring in speakers, you know, even if they're debating a speaker who's a little bit more like, you know, with the Hillsdale program, just having some people here who are willing to stand up and say, like, yeah, maybe gay people can be part of the church and not have to pretend that they're not gay or be celibate or whatever. Talks and events like that, especially when they come from the administration and are funded by the administration, are hugely important and make a huge difference. I would also love to see events like that coming from like Lighthouse, other campus groups, which I'm not sure if that's a thing that the administration has much say in, but you know, just talking about like the mental health impacts of being LGBT at a non-affirming college, like they are significant. And then, gee, I really feel like I like planned for this question so that I could like have it like a nice like a list of demands to like.
Well, as like an admissions counselor, I'm not sure how much I can do, but.
That's interesting. Admissions counselor. I think just really, really just emphasizing that, as evinced by the number of attendees of this talk tonight, there really are people here on this campus who want to engage in this dialogue. Like, if you become the admissions counselor to a student who, I don't know, looks kind of gay, maybe find a moment to say to them, like, there are resources on this campus for you. Like, there are counselors in the Health and Wellness Center who will listen to what you have to say and not come at you judgmentally. And there are people on this campus who love you and support you and want to talk with you about your experiences. You know, like, obviously they should know that, like, the administration as a whole isn't the most affirming administration ever, but that being said, this also doesn't have to be the worst place to go to school as a gay student if we make it that way.
Can I ask a follow-up question?
Yeah, absolutely.
So for me, I think I would even, and I would be way more interested in hearing your experience because I'm a straight cisgender woman, I wouldn't be like, oh yeah, you're gay, like that's gonna be totally cool here. Like, do you even think that that is like, would they be happier elsewhere?
I mean, to be quite honest, if they personally also take a gay affirming approach to themselves, yes, they definitely would be happier elsewhere. And like, if they ask you that question forthrightly, it's like, you're probably not allowed to say that, but like, that would be my opinion. However, if they are like me, because I started to realize that I was gay in like high school, and it was only until I like came to college that I was like, oh, this is like a real thing and not just like a pretend high school thing. It was really only then that I really appreciated being here, just because of like the intellectual environment and because I felt like I could discuss things with people. And even if like being gay was a topic that always seemed like it was off the table, like, guys, I wish I'd had this presentation like a year ago. Like, there's so many of you here. Like, I wish that I realized that. You know what I mean? So, yeah, I think just, like, communicating that if a student is like, this is really the intellectual environment where I want to be, like, this is the school that I want to be at, but I don't know if I'll be happy here, then my advice would be, intellectually, you will love it. Socially, and, like, for your mental health, like, be aware of this list of things. But you know what I mean? So, like, yeah, that would help. I think that's kind of the approach I would take. And anyone else? Yeah. Hi, Joe.
Hi.
Hi, guys.
just kind of a closing question, I guess. Could you just give us a little bit more of an insight into your experience here at Hillsdale? You're graduating, you know, like, just kind of, what was it like kind of developing in your identity and having these friends? What was it like coming out, and like, what was it like having these conversations? Because this is a formal presentation, right? And
yes.
So this is a different kind of mode, but yeah, so, I mean, what were we like?
Yeah, so I'm about to settle into the long haul here. 5-minute answer minimum. It's okay. even after I like cut my hair and like kind of started not caring about what people thought about me, sort of, but like I still cared a little bit. But like I didn't come out to anyone here. I mean, until like again, like May 2nd, 2016, that was the dead end of my sophomore year, and that was like 5 people. And then like, yeah, so I mean, I've been explicitly out for a while in like a regional swing dance community and like the forensics community, which are both things that I travel to all the time. Like, by the way, if you're wondering why I'm gone every weekend, it's because it's good for my mental health to be around people like that. Like, to be quite honest, it can be good to get a break from being here. There's been a lot of times when I drive down that road past the Walmart and see the clock tower and think, here we go again. Really. I mean, gosh, I could point you to so many experiences. Here's a quick one. I was sitting in AJ once and overheard a couple of guys at the next table saying, gee, I can't believe Bruce Jenner thinks he's a woman. Like, calling him Bruce, he, him pronouns, we all know her name is Caitlin. And like that, and I was sitting there like, do I say something? It's horribly offensive to me, but I felt like I couldn't say anything to them because it wasn't safe for me to be out, you know? Some of the stuff that's gone on this campus with, you know, far-right extremists doing stuff, like, you better believe that's something that makes me feel not safe on this campus as a gay person. There have been times I've been walking back to my dorm at night, and I mean, I'm not afraid of sexual assault. Most people can't tell I'm a woman anyway from a distance, but... like, I'm not afraid of sexual assault, but, like, you know, I may be walking past one of the men's dorms and thinking, like, man, like, some of these people and their political beliefs, I really don't know what they would do to me if they got me alone. And like, that's a real fear that I have. Yeah, but like, that's not fun to say. Oh, okay, here's something we can talk about. Mike Pence, y'all. So remember that part in my presentation where I went super hard after conversion therapy? Conversion therapy is something that Mike Pence has explicitly supported for years. And I was so frustrated and so enraged when it was announced that he was going to be my commencement speaker. I can't do anything about that. I have to attend commencement because my immediate family will be there, I'm not out to them, and if I'm not there, they'll ask me why. But, I mean, man, I almost had a panic attack in class the day it was announced because I couldn't stop thinking about it. That was such hard news. It is still such hard news. So, yeah, that, I guess, was a hard thing that came about because I'm Hillsdale and gay. Other things. Here's like a thing that happened like a couple months ago. So I had a friend of mine come here to visit me. She's from Milwaukee, swing dance friend, super cool. She ended up like it was her spring break. She just kind of like hang with me for a couple days. We're tight. And like we were just walking around campus, like holding hands, you know, like friends do. It's platonic, seriously. But like I could see people staring and I was like, ah. Because honestly, like that was, you know, like I knew that people were making an assumption about me that they don't make every time girls around here hold hands, which happens a lot, a little bitter. Series on marriage and relationships. I was like, no, like that was the last time of my own volition set foot in a Protestant church in 2 years. Because I was like, I can't sit there and listen to somebody else tell me that I'm going to have a wonderful husband someday. It's not gonna happen, guys. Like, I really hope that I have a wonderful wife someday. That would be delightful. But even if that doesn't happen, like, that mixed orientation marriage, not in my book, no sir. After that, I started going to St. Anthony's, like, to the Catholic Church for a while. I would wear jeans and a hoodie, sneak in the back, and leave as soon as, like, the handing out the Eucharist ended, because, like, I felt like I needed to go to church somewhere, but I also knew that no one in St. Anthony's would understand, which is weird, because I do now know that there are people who go to St. Anthony's. since then. And it's been a laundry list of churches, you guys. I was going to an Eastern Orthodox church for a while, but like, I got the lunch thing, you guys, like the food after church. They are so about that. But they were giving me free food after the service, and like, it got to the point where I was like, man, I gotta become a member of this church, or like, all this free food is wasted on me. But you can't be chrismated into the Eastern Orthodox Church if you don't accept their doctrine that homosexuality is outside of, you know, the goodness of God's creation. So, I mean, I would really love to be Eastern Orthodox. I feel that that's a tradition I fit into strongly. I love the liturgy. I love everything about it. It is never going to happen for me. Thanks for the question, Joe. Yeah, so, closing question. All right. We're done. Thank you for coming. Guacamole, that is for you. I made it for you. Enjoy. Happy finals, everyone.